one last Mohican in front of you now, just before the lunch. One great information for you. We started late because everybody was doing B2B, so the lunch is not starting now, it's starting after the last presentation. It is time for us to meet Mr. Siniša Pintarić from Honeywell. Ajde, Sine, sad će nam se I on pridružiti. Dakle, za sve koji nisu 100% sigurni, nahranit ćemo vas, ali mrvicu kasnije. And after that, you still need to have your applications of the Adria Security Summit on your mobile phones, because you will be needing it much more tomorrow for the case study competition. And before that, you can just send somebody personal message, like you can send a personal message to this lovely lady and she can say that she is on the summit and she won't answer the question. Siniša, dobrodošao.
Dobrodošao.
Evo, izvolim, sjedi tu malo, odmori s ove strane. Just before the lunch, it's always nice to talk about fire. So you like fire? Well, you don't like fire, like preventing fire.
Definitely.
And I have to ask the question. I think the first one, smoke detector, was invented in 1920s, right?
Yeah, optical detector.
Okay, so you're the only guy who remembers time before that.
Definitely. Yeah, definitely. We will be shortly speaking also a little bit about the history of the fire detection.
So screaming fire, fire is already too late. You're doing everything to know that fire starts much before the fire.
I will explain it to the short history because, okay. Yeah, screaming was a nice method using for the fire prevention in the past before electricity.
Okay, we're waiting for your presentation, screaming lunch, lunch.
Okay, so I'll do it shortly because everybody's
no
hungry.
Take your time. Siniša, izvoli.
Hi, everybody. My name is Siniša Pintarić, and today the subject of my presentation will be fire and fire prevention. We will shortly go through the history of the fire systems, history of detection. We will pass through the quickness of detection and the types of detection. Also, the focus of the presentation will be on the DTS, which is linear heat detection, the system that is only not preventing fire and keeping people and project safety, but also is lowering the downtime for very important projects like infrastructure projects and industry projects. So let's start with a short history. Okay, so I believe that first fire that you know, that everybody knows, is Nero burning Rome, as I remember. So this was one of the biggest fire in the history written. Also, I found some information that even in that time there was some kind of protection for the fire, which was some kind of Roman legions that was working as a fire extinguisher guys. But the theory was going like, they go to the place, they then ask the owner of the building, how much will you give us the money to protect your building, and then they make agreement, yeah? But in the shorter history, we can start with the New York, which was the first fire patrol. It was called a rattle walk, which means that it was a group of eight people walking in the night with bells, and saying to the citizens of the city if there is some kind of a fire alarm or what is happening on. In 1985, in Boston, there was the first transmission of the fire alarm message. It was done through the telegraph. 1863 was the first pneumatic detector. This pneumatic detector was based on a bimetal technology, which is now used also for the thermostat. On 1879, we have the first telegraph station box, which was a telegraph box for calling the fire department if you notice the fire. In 1890, there was a first, I would say, home detector that was a thermal detector. And in 1896, there was a foundation of NFPA, which is a National Fire Protection Association. And this is a non-profit organization that is devoted to protecting lives and projects and objects, of course. And of course, in 1920, we invented the first smoke detector. So, what is a fire and how does it affect? We can say that fire has two types of effects. It has an energy effect and has a material effect. An energy effect is radiation. So we have a visible range of radiation. We have IR radiation and ultraviolet radiation. We also have a conduction and convection effect, which means that fire is changing the flow of the air. It also makes sound and it produces heat. For the materials, we can shorten them in volatile and non-volatile materials. Non-volatile materials are metals. Metals in fire either melt to liquid, either they stay in a solid state. Also, volatile products like, I don't know, wood, textile or something like this, burning of these materials creates steam, creates CO2, CO gas, also creates smokes, and what is important, it creates also invisible smokes, which can be also deadly. So every material doesn't burn the same. This is very important to notice. So by the ISO standard, there is the fires, type of fires are spread from TF1 to TF9. So for instance, let's say on TF1, we have an open cellulose wood fire. This is what we use for the barbecue, maybe. This is most used to us. On TF2, we have a rapid smolder pyrolysis. This is only smoke practically coming at the start. So we can notice here that a lot of materials do not burn in the same way. And also, there is not always smoke. There is black smoke, there is white smoke, there is no smoke fire. There is even fire without seeing the flames. Yeah. Today, I would also like to mention, just to understand a little bit more, how we divide the fire detection. We have the non-automatic detectors. These are manual call points, usually push buttons, let's say, which are used in objects like this to start the fire procedure to evacuate the building and everything. It's just a push button. On the other side, we have automatic detectors. Automatic detectors, first we can put them as a smoke detectors, so which means that they only react when they see smoke. Smoke detectors can be divided also in optical detectors, ionization detectors, which are not anymore in use because they had a radioactive material inside for a detection. But we now use multi-criterial also devices, and these are devices that are having not only optical part inside, but they also could have thermal sight, and they can also have a gas detection. Next would be the heat detector. So the heat detector is reacting only on the temperature. We divide them in thermodifferential and thermomaximal. Thermodifferential is depending on the change in the temperature, and thermomaximal is reacting only to the specific temperature. We have also the flame detectors. Flame detectors, you can imagine them like cameras that are looking at the specific position. And these flame detectors are searching for specific characteristics of the fire in the UV and IR spectrum of the light. Also, there is a special detectors, which we will talk about today, which is this linear heat detector. To describe a little bit today what fire and how to prevent fire and what is fire detection speed, let's see this graph. And the first system that is most reliable today on the market is aspiration system. This is the system that will firstly react to the fire. He even starts noticing fire system even when there is still invisible smoke. System is done with pipes which take the air out of the room, put it to the central unit, and this central unit is quickly evaluating is there any aerosols inside of detection. Next, we go to the smoke detector, which is OTG. Why OTG? Because first, when there is a fire, what you see first is CO2 is becoming is the first thing that is growing from the fire. So the CO, the value of the CO will certainly be the first indication that there is a fire. Next, we have the OT blue detector, which is using, which is much more reliable detector in the fast airflows, and it's exchanged, let's say, for the ionization detectors that today are not more in use. Then we come to the optical detector, which you see that the fire has already started, there is a smoke already inside, and the optical detector will react only, let's say, in the middle of this. Flame detector, as we explained, will react only when they see a flame. So that means that project or the object or the thing that we are looking at is already burning. So we usually use the flame detectors for the industrial projects. And last, we have the thermal detection, and the thermal detection, of course, is reacting only to when the temperature is rising, which means that the complete building could be already on the fire. I included this all here also, the sprinkler. Sprinkler is an extinguishing system which uses water, gases or stuff like this. And he's also a thermal, reacts on the thermal, on the temperature level. What will we be discussing mostly, and why I put this topic, is how to use, this is a technology that is all long on the market. But I would like to show you how we use this technology in, not only, as I said, to keep the projects safe and people safe, but also to lower the downtime of the projects, like infrastructure and industry projects. The system of DTS is divided in two parts. One is panel and the other one is detector cable. DTS means distributed temperature sensing. And we will go to now how it works. So, the principle of DTS detector. As we notice, we said it uses a central station and it uses an optical cable. We know that the light in optical cable is not going directly. It goes, it bounces off from the core of the cable, and this is called backscattering. Physical values like temperature, like tension, like pressure are affecting optical cables and affecting this kind of backlight scattering. Indian physicist Mr. Raman discovered this method by pushing the laser pulse through the optical cable and then measuring this backscattered light. This backscattered light, what he is measuring, this is just 1% of the change in the signal, but he noticed that if he used this signal, which we can see on the graph left down, if he calculates these two signals, he can get the temperature level of the cable, and it can be done in 1 meter radius. Which means if you have a 10 kilometer cable, you can detect in 1 meter where the change has happened, either temperature or tension or pressure. So we explain how it works. What we use optical cables. There is nothing special, it's an optical cable, but what is special, the cable must be FRNC, which means fire retardant non-corrosive cable. Usually we use two multimode optical fibers because the signal has to go back. And we are on the market, mostly used cables are Fernitzer Safety and Fernitzer Steel, which depends on the type of the project where you will be using it. These cables must be very tough, must be robust, because in the projects like industry or in tunnels or infrastructure, the environment is not so friendly, I would say. So what are the benefits of using this kind of a technology? DTS is, so first of all, what I would like to say is environmental resistance of the sensor cables. The cable is completely resistant to UV radiation, so it's an optical cable. Resistance to the water and humidity because of the outer shell, shelter of the cable and everything. also resistant to oil, dust, resistant to corrosive atmospheres, totally electrically passive sensor optical cable, totally immune to any kind of induced surge or lightnings, and totally immune to the any kind of electromagnetic disturbances. Second thing why it's also why to use this technology is explosion safety, detection speed and longevity. So DTS uses a laser which is a very low power laser, which means it's safe for the human to use them. Lower, also it's ATEX approved, which means that it can be, it's ATEX is a certification for explosive environment, and if you have a ATEX certificate, it means that this equipment can be used in such an environment. This kind of detection, this kind of system can be used in explosive environments such as gas, explosive gases, explosive dust, and also in mines. One good benefit, very great benefit, is there is no maintenance. So there is nothing to change, no filter, no recalibration of the system. There is nothing here regarding the maintenance. Sensor cable, optical cable can have 40 years of longevity. And also DTS detector is approved by FAUDES as EN54.45 as a sensor as a thermal sensor. So we have more benefits. And the third benefit that I would like to mention is temperature and resistance of the sensor. So we can see here that this kind of a system can be used in many varieties because of their advantages. One of the big advantages is operating temperature. Operating temperature in the normal conditions is 40 degrees to plus 85 degrees. It can work 1 hour for minus 50 degrees to 150 degrees plus. Indoor and outdoor applications, which means that it's completely tolerant to the icing, snow, and any kind of environment falls. It's also, we mentioned fire safety. Furnace safety cable has a pH 15, which means it's resistible 15 minutes in a fire. Furnace steel cable is pH 120, which means that he's resisting fire for 120 minutes, 2 hours. Also, very important that furnace steel cable can work in 2 hours in 750 degrees Celsius. So this is very good, I would say, advantage. Also, as we said, furnace means non-corrosive, which means that cable is halogen-free, safe for people and buildings if the fire happens. Just to explain a little bit how it's configured and how do you do this kind of system. So you can see on the first slide, we have an optical, on the first picture, let's say upstairs, we have an optical cable of 10 kilometers connected to the DTS unit. We see here test zone, detection zone, and test zone. What is this test zone? Test zone, let's say, take it as a tunnel. If you have a tunnel and the cable is going on the ceiling, the testing cannot be done very easily because the tunnel is always running, everything is going, which means that usually what people do, what the project designs do, they use a roll of cable just before and after the and at the end of the cable to make a test zone. So you don't need to climb on the ceiling to test if the fire detection is working. You're just using this, you put it in a closet or this cable and just test it right there. So it's you will have the testing from the end and from the beginning, so you'll be aware if it's working or not. Of course, DTS can be connected to integrated together with the PC, which means we can send either through industrial protocols like Modbus, or we can send informations to TCP/IP to receive the graphical visualization of the system. Of course, it needs to be also connected to the fire alarm panels to receive the messages to be resetted in a case of a fire. We see here also on the pictures below that DTS can have not only one detection, but can have two detectors inside, which brings us redundancy, which means in the middle case with one sensor going back, anywhere you cut it, you will still have the redundancy, so the full working operating cable. Also, we have a double redundancy in the last one, because you have two units, two cables, and anything, if one unit is not working, the other unit will take it over. If you have a cable broken or something like that, from both units you will still have the signal and the system will be working. So, where do we use DTS mainly? I divided this into four parts. So we use it as a power cable monitoring measurement, which means the measurement. So you have the high voltage, high voltage power, this ones, I don't know how they call it, dalekovodi. And what do we do? We use DTS to monitor the lines of the high voltage pillars. And this is very useful because even if the cable is broken, even there is a fire and everything, it will be recognized. Second, we use it for a fire detection monitoring. We use it in the tunnels mainly. Mainly this system is known to be used in the tunnels. But we can also use it, as I will explain later, as a system in industry to prevent also not fire, but also to keep the downtime of the project very low. Oil, gas, geo and hydrology. So now everybody's talking about pipelines. Pipelines, we have a lot of projects in Europe with the pipelines, and these pipelines also needs to be protected. Maybe you read somewhere in Nigeria, for instance, I read that local people are drilling the pipelines to take the oil out of the from the pipeline. Usually those people got burned and there is a lot of accidents because of this. You put the optical cable directly with the pipeline and then you can monitor if there is a leakage, if there is some kind of a change or whatever. Regarding industrial, where there is a lot of, I would say industrial, it's a matter of imagination where we can use it. What we say, we can use it also in the dams, LNG facilities. What is also important, and I almost forget it, DTS can be used, as I said, as a tension. So he can also detect the tension. Let's say we had a bridge collapse in Genova. So this kind of projects, if you put DTS on the concrete of the bridge in this case, you can monitor if there is some kind of a movement of the bridge, and this kind of an accident can be avoided then. So at the end, I would like to explain what we did, our colleagues from Honeywell, how did they use the DTS systems to improve the, not only as I mentioned, the fire safety of the project and the people working there, but also it's reduced the downtime of the factory, and I will shortly explain it. So we are talking about thermoelectrical coal plant, which means you have a coal which is going with the belt conveyors to the main generator. It goes there, it burns and creates electrical energy. The main issue of these thermoelectrical plants were burning of belt conveyors. So you have a belt conveyors that can go to 100 meters, and what happens? This belt conveyor is the heart of this because it brings the material coal directly to the generator, and if this conveyor belt broke, usually what breaks, it's a rubber belt that is going there, and it burns because of the rollers. Rollers get so hot because of the usage from 024, they get so hot that they burn this rubber. In this case, if the rubber, which is long 100, 300 meters, breaks down, the guys from thermal electrical plant needs at least 4 to 5 hours to replace this belt again. So this was their issue. It was not also this kind of roller that is on a heat can also create a fire. And there is a lot of materials below the belt conveyor, and also the on the belt conveyor there is a coal, so it can get fire. What they used, they tried to find a solution how to prevent this, how to make it better. And what they used even thermal cameras to see which of the rollers is on heat and maybe then exchange the roller and not to burn the belt. So I will cut it shortly what we did. With all the advantages that I already mentioned, important thing was we used DTS to make their project very safe and to lower this downtime. What happened? We used DTS, as we said, DTS advantages on this case is localization up to 1 meter. So you can really know which of the roller is on fire in 1 meter, so it can be seen. Also, temperature visualization. So we said we have an integration. We can integrate this system and make a graphical visualization of the system, which bring us to this. And which brings us to this picture. No, to this picture. Okay, so we can integrate the picture of the heat of the rollers inside of the graphical system. Three things that were also the problem. The problem was the heat transmission. Heat from the rollers, we had a problem how to make the heat transmitted to the cable. So the guys used the metal cores to advance this, to connect it directly with the belts and to get the temperature even higher to the cable. Second was the heat radiation. So the rollers were hot as 200 degrees Celsius. So this was also a problem not to burn the cables. And the third thing was also the convection of the energy of the heat. Heat was going because of the rolling and the process that is always moving. The heat was always moving away. So we needed to cleverly put the optical cable on the right positions. So what we did was use the DTS unit, and here is the solution what we did, which is putting the cable which can go 10 kilometers, we said, and this is the positions of the cables that we use. So in this kind of solution, we are monitoring the complete, not only rollers, but also the place below the rollers, which is giving information to the local guys that when the system is on too much heat and what happens. They don't go and change the belt now. They go when they notice, when they have information, this roller is 150 degrees, they go now there and they just change the roller, which means there is no more 3-4 hours downtime of the factory. We change this now to half hour maybe changing. So this is very important for a project like infrastructure to, because the downtime needs to be lower because they need to work 24/7. At the end, also we visualize these systems to them, and it brings them quite a fast, reliable information on time. And this is it regarding this solution. I hope that you like the presentation, and if you have more questions, please visit us on Honeywell stand. Hvala.